notes. All right. So here I am at a field hospital. The gentleman right before me is going to explain the different amputations that they used to do back in the war. Could you explain like what a typical amputation would be and why they would amputate?
Mm-hmm. Basically, what happens is you've got a situation where there's so much damage to the foot or to the hand that we cannot repair it. In those days, they really couldn't repair any type of bone fractures or compound fractures. These would get infected, and then the chances were you'd get gangrene and you would die. So the point was we would try to do the amputations as quickly as possible. This is called a double flap amputation, and it was performed rather simply. It doesn't require too many different instruments. The first thing that was done was they would use ether or chloroform, and they would hold it over the patient. Well, actually, the first thing was using the tourniquet to stop the flow of the blood. So in the leg would be in the thigh, and in the upper arm if it was the arm. And they would drip the chloroform into the top. He would then breathe it in with some air, and then he would be able to go to sleep. This was an important new thing. 1846, 47 is when they invent ether and chloroform. Before that time period, they were wide awake when you had to cut off an arm or a leg.
So how would they numb the pain, or if
anything? You would give you a bite stick to put in your mouth, and that was about it. There was no such thing as biting the bullet.
Ouch.
So that didn't happen. I don't know where that came from. Basically, the operation was very simple. Once the tourniquet and he was asleep, they would take the amputation knife and he would cut down up underneath and then cut down around down to the bone. Once he was down to the bone, the assistant would come in. He would usually use what was called a retractor, where he would use his fingers to pull back the flesh so that he could get as much of the bone as possible, and he would come in and cut the bone off. They then discarded the limbs into piles or buckets or barrels. And then what you ended up with then, this is called a double flap amputation. There are different types. This was a circular like this, and it was made with a, what we call a circular type of amputation knife, and it went down around like that. This was the preferred method in the Revolutionary War and up to the beginning of the Civil War. They also did what was called a single flap amputation, which is where you only had a single, and then the idea was that the flap would come up. This was important because they needed to have a flap to cover that bone so that you could use a prosthetic. That's what was bad with the circular. So with the double flap, he then would take what was called the tenaculum. I'm going to find one here. And the tenaculum was used by going up inside and then pulling the blood vessel out like that. When he would pull it out, he then could take his suture string and he would tie a suture and tie a knot around it. They also sometimes would cauterize, but the favorite method during the Civil War was to use a suture and tie a knot. Then once he did that, he would use what was called a bone file. And he would file the edges of the bone. He'd feel for the, make sure they were smooth. And he would file those down and make sure they were smooth. Because if he didn't do that, then the bone could cut through the muscle. Then once that was done, he simply folded the two together and sewed it closed. And then a pad would be placed on the end, or bandage. And they would change the bandage like every day. And then put a sock over it too. And hopefully the pus that would form in them would just be drained off and they would be able to survive. The average in the Civil War is 3 out of 10 don't survive.
So that's 30% mortality?
Like 30. You know, so I mean, yeah, so I guess it would be 3 out of 10 wouldn't make it. So that's like 30%, I guess.
Wow.
But, you know, the difference was, like, if you lost your fingers or your hands, that was only like 2.5%. The problem was, as you get further up to the trunk, it becomes greater. If I had to take off like at your hip, it was like an 85 to 90% chance you weren't going to live. Same thing up to your shoulder.
I see.
Okay. So the further away from the trunk, the better chance. Also, any time when you're amputating the legs, there was a greater death rate in the legs, so your circulatory system isn't as good.
Wow, incredible.
And then they did what was called urology. You want to see urology real quick?
Sure.
Urology, based on, in this particular case, that the soldier can't go to the bathroom, so they tried to use a urinary probe to try to free the blockage up so that they could get a catheter in, maybe. They tried going up inside of him like this, up into his bladder, and that didn't work, so they couldn't get a catheter in him. The next thing that they would do is they would use a scalpel, and they would slice through his belly above the bladder, and then use a retractor to open it up. Then they used what was called a trocar, which is a hollow tube with a real sharp device, and that would get plunged right on down into your bladder like that. And then when he did, he could remove the top and the urine would be able to come out just like that.
Incredible.
Okay, then they would leave this in and sop up the urine as the days go by, and then hopefully we'd be able to clear the blockage out and so he could go to the bathroom.
What was the survival rate for doing a procedure?
Not very good. There were only 420 cases of urology surgery done during the Civil War, and of only, I think out of those, it was like 12 were considered successful.
Ouch.
Anytime you went into the body from the head to the groin, chances were you weren't going to survive.
Wow.
The famous operation is Joshua Chamberlain, which took 12 to 14 hours with four surgeons, where the bullet had gone through his side and lodged in his hip and had punctured his bladder. And basically the types of things I just showed you were similar things that had to be done to him. But he, with no anesthesia, he was begging them to let him die. But eventually he becomes a morphine addict, and he lives, though, to become the governor of Maine, and lives to, I think, his 80s. But he eventually dies from a complication of this operation.
Really?
He had just constant bladder infections, urinary infections, and it was just really terrible for him.
Which battle was he shot at?
Petersburg in 1864.
Now,
he was wounded at Gettysburg in his foot.
Right.
But this particular one, he thought he wanted to die. It was that bad. And if he had been a regular soldier, hadn't been the famous Lieutenant Colonel Chamberlain, they wouldn't even have attempted to save him.
And how badly did that morphine addiction affect his life?
Well, don't know how much. He becomes the governor of Maine, so it must not have affected him that much. But I'm sure it wasn't, you know, something good to have.
He laid there for 12 to 14 hours while they probed in his body like that.
It cut him open. It was one of the most, it was a groundbreaking surgery when they did it, because they actually had to go into the bladder and seal the bladder back up and get in there, and that really was never done. It was
They had medications to be able to put these patients out. Why was he left alone?
We can't keep you asleep that long with ether and chloroform.
I see.
The best is like maybe 15 minutes.
Was it that toxic?
Is that toxic? And then the problem is you can, the chances of you going into respiratory failure were just too great. Plus,
really?
you can die. It's like a poison, so it could kill you if you could use too much of it. So that was that. You couldn't keep them out. A normal amputation of an arm was only about 5 minutes. The record is like 40 some seconds for a leg. That's how fast they could do them. A normal leg was usually anywhere from 5 to 10 minutes in that realm. The idea was to be quick. And remember, and before the Civil War, they had to be really fast, because they were wide awake and you're holding them down.
And what they would use to tie off these arteries, catgut and all kinds
of...
silk.
And then again, if you were out of all that, you just used thread. You used whatever was available. I mean, there's the old thing about them using horsehair.
Yeah.
But that had, you know, what was interesting with that is to get it pliable, they boiled it. Mm. Well, guess what happened when they boiled it? They made it sterile. So they didn't see the infection problem. So. Same problem with bandages. We would use the same bandages over and over again.
Okay, so here's a question for you.
Head south on Table Rock Road.